Humility and leadership. Humility in the biblical sense could be described as a human state of loneliness or affliction in relation to God. The scriptures commonly contrast humility with pride, violence, and arrogance, while associating the term with meekness and patience. The Old Testament word for humbled referred primarily to the poor and afflicted, but the New Testament used it in a larger framework by applying it to more subjective traits of Christian character. From the beginning, Israel was rejected by the noble segment of the world. It was important for them to remain aware of their humble beginnings in Egyptian slavery and of the fact that their deliverance came from God's grace rather than their merit. Israel was not a nation built on pride, wealth, and human strengths, but to the contrary, it depended solely on the workings of God who delivers the humble. Their strength came from their knowledge, meant on their helplessness and utter dependence on God. One finds instances where God humbled individuals and even entire bodies. But God chose Israel not for human qualities, abilities, or achievements, but because of divine love and the covenants of their forefathers. In the New Testament, the humble are not just those who are poor, afflicted, or lonely in society, as the Old Testament indicates, but are those who possess a Christian virtue or attitude which is to be desired by all. Jesus is the prime example for a humble lifestyle. New Testament writers remembered their human heritage and God's concern for the poor and His resistance of the proud. In a nutshell, Christian humility means a lack of concern for one's own prestige and a desire to please God only. Now, this definition makes no reference to how people dress, their education, nor their prosperity, if these are handled properly. In fact, one can be proud of what society traditionally considers humble situations. For example, it is possible to take pride in being poor, uneducated, and holy. Christ did not consider the religious leaders of His day to be humble men. This is evidenced by the fact that none of the 12 pillars of the church which Christ chose was among the religious leaders of His day. Christ's most vigorous criticism was not aimed at the sinners, but at the religious leaders. He did not condone sin, but most of those who are confessed sinners realize their predicament. In fact, sinners usually view themselves as being unworthy of God or as being too lowly to merit His acceptance. However, the religious Pharisees felt that God was fortunate to have them on His side. They went to extremes to prove their holiness and humility. They would not be caught dead speaking or associated with those whom they considered to be outcasts from the realm of God. Pride is an unholy, worldly characteristic which creeps into the heart of many and stifles the working of the Spirit. Parents train their children to be independent beings, so they will not be a burden on society. However, Christ asks persons to surrender their independence, thus becoming humbly dependent on Him. Great leaders in this world usually are those that are able to display an air of self-confidence and assurance, which gives their followers a sense of security. But Christian leaders must perform the works of their office without receiving personal glory to their accomplishments. You see, when the Apostle Paul and Barnabas visited Lystra, God healed a person through the ministry of Paul. Now, those who witnessed the act assumed that the missionaries were gods. Paul and Barnabas viewed these as a repulsive mistake, and they pleaded with the people, saying, "Sirs, why do ye do these things? We also are men of like passions." They knew it, and they knew that it was important to remember that they were only humans. Some leaders might have seized the opportunity which was before Paul to start an evangelistic campaign featuring healing and prophecy. Their names and pictures would have been plastered all over the town, and Jesus would have been noticeably only to the most careful observer. The humble person realizes that God is the source of all things. Ministers and other leaders are in a position where their egos often are battered by those to whom they minister on one hand, and lifted undeservedly to the highest level by others. When this happens, pride slips into their constitution as a protective instrument without their knowledge. Instead of working at being humble, it is more profitable to find the source of self-pride. For example, the private leader may be trying to hide feelings of inferiority. Humility is not something a person accomplishes or achieves for the remainder of his life. Maintaining humility is an ongoing process. Earthly people may never be able to say, "I am a humble person." In order to overcome each problem that arises, leaders must humble themselves before God and ask for His assistance. Now, while a leader can never truly say, "Well, from now on, I am a humble person," one may point out different situations and events of his or her life and say that at that particular situation, they humbled themselves before God, and because of this, God helped them. Now, the Church of God has not progressed as a result of talented, well-trained leaders. The Church's strength lies in its ability to humble itself before God in total surrender and plead for His intervention. The Church of God cannot compete with the educated, the talented, and worldly denominations of the world, and should not attempt to do so. The Church of God is built upon little people who believe in a large God.